cough syrups. So cough is forceful expulsion of the air from the lungs. So we actually cough, we close the glottis and we expire against a closed glottis. So that's the reason why you get a severe spasm of air that comes out. It's a protective mechanism, so you are not always worried about the cough. Only when the cough becomes too much and you get worried that probably this child will go into a pneumothorax or he may have a conjunctival bleed, that's the time that you actually want to control the cough. Or it's very irritating, it's disturbing the sleep, then you want to control the cough. Otherwise, cough is basically a good mechanism of removing whatever foreign body has come into the windpipe. How does the cough reflex work? How do we get the cough? It's basically the cough center is in the medulla oblongata. So when you want to suppress cough, you could use something that works on the central nervous system. So that's why your dextromethorphan or codeine are the drugs that suppress cough by acting at the central nervous system. And peripheral, the cough receptors are present in the pharynx, the larynx, the trachea, the lungs, everywhere. So whatever stimulates the peripheral receptors will then finally go into the medulla oblongata and cause a cough reflex. It could be dry air. Some people just get cough when they go into the AC. The dryness of the air causes a cough. Sometimes it may just be some irritation, some foreign body has gone inside. Or dust, you just got exposure to dust, you started coughing. Or you got a viral infection or a bacterial infection, or you got an allergy, you got edema, and that has started causing cough. Now, most important is to identify the type of cough, because once you identify it correctly, you can give a proper medication. There are two types of cough. You have dry cough and you have wet cough. Now, you may be told that laryngeal cough is barking kind of cough, brassy cough. So there are different types of cough that you can identify. But what is important is from the treatment point of view, what are you going to give? So dry cough and wet cough. Now, if you start right from the nose, we get cough because of nasopharyngitis. We may get cough because of post-nasal drip. So post-nasal drip cough is also dry. It's irritating the throat. Nasopharyngitis may be initially dry, then may become wet, and then again becomes dry. Post a URTI, you can get wet cough. Pharyngitis can give you wet cough. But then that cough tends to remain for a pretty long time. It's known as post-infectious cough, which may remain for some time. So that is an irritating cough. And sometimes you have taken Ayurvedic preparations for it. Actually, you've taken Khadiradi or you've taken Sitopladi to just control that dry, irritating cough that is there. So pharyngitis initially would have wet and then it becomes dry. Similarly, laryngitis is dry cough, but you can identify laryngeal cough because of change in voice. There's a change in the voice with the laryngeal cough. If you go down, trachea is going to be wet cough because there's copious amount of sputum that is generated. Bronchitis initially would be dry. So asthma initially would be dry, but subsequently with more fluid going into the airways, it becomes a wet cough. Pneumonia is always a wet cough. Then we come to the pleura. Pleura is going to be dry cough because there's no sputum being secreted. I think the cough rate goes up.
Yeah, trigger.
Trigger factor. Yes. And then bronchiectasis, lung abscess, all those are going to be wet cough. Tuberculosis could be both dry or wet, depending on where the TB is. If you have a primary complex, it's going to be a dry cough. If you have a mediastinal node compressing a bronchus, it's going to be a dry cough. Miliary TB may be dry or wet. Pleural effusion would be dry. Fibrocavitary TB or primary progressive TB would be a wet cough. Okay, so depending on the location where the infection is, you get a different kind of a cough. Most important is to identify dry or wet so that you decide which cough syrups to use. Now, what you said, OTCs, over-the-counter pills or cough syrups, as per American Academy of Pediatrics, not recommended in children less than 6 years. So cough syrup should not be used in children less than 6 years, except for probably anti-allergic, anti-asthma drugs, okay? Not cough suppressants and all that. Because of lack of evidence showing effect and concerns of harm. In fact, there have been instances where I have also seen cases, child was given antihistaminic and has come to the ward as excessive sleepiness. So some of these do cause, like your antihistaminics, the first generation do cause a lot of sleepiness. So you should try and avoid using cough syrups as far as possible in children less than 6 years. Probably salbutamol is one that could be used in a wheezing child. You could use cetirizine above 6 months of age as an antihistaminic, but cetirizine is preferably preferred in children who have allergic rhinitis. Just runny nose is not an indication for using antihistaminic or cetirizine. All the other antihistaminics, including your fexofenadine, that's your Allegra, should not be used in children less than 6 years of age. Cochrane review, there is no evidence for or against the effectiveness of OTC medicines in acute cough. Okay, so we have a lot of evidence to say that don't use, probably because we don't know how it helps or how it works or whether it causes any harm. Now, there are 5 types of cough syrups in broad classification that you could consider: cough expectorant, cough suppressant. You have bronchodilators, you have decongestants, and you've got mucolytics. So these are the 5 basic types. Depending on the type of cough that is there, you select a particular cough expectorant. Cough expectorants. Now, basically, cough expectorants only makes the mucus thin. So it makes the mucus easier to cough out. And it relieves the chest congestion so that breathing is easier. It has got no role on the bronchi. It doesn't help in wheezing. It just makes your secretions thinner. So it's mainly useful in wet cough. So it's very useful for pneumonias. Pneumonias, lung abscess, bronchiectasis. So this is where it is useful. And your commonest cough expectorant is guaifenesin. There are other ingredients that are there in a lot of cough expectorants. You have got potassium iodide in a few cough syrups. You also have menthol in a few cough syrups. Basically, they are not expectorants. Potassium iodide is, but you try and avoid a cough syrup which contains potassium iodide because of the risk of thyroid problems with that. Menthol just soothes. It gives you a soothing feeling. So it's not really, most of the cough syrups will contain menthol, so it doesn't harm. Now, the main ingredient of a cough expectorant is guaifenesin. What you must remember is you should not use any antihistaminic along with guaifenesin because they've got contradictory effect. Guaifenesin is going to put water into that mucus and make it thinner, and antihistaminics are going to dry up the secretion. So they've got counter effect. Guaifenesin basically draws the water into the bronchi, it thins the mucus, lubricates the airway, and facilitates removal of the mucus by coughing. One of the adverse effects of guaifenesin is a dry mouth. So always whenever you give this cough syrup, you tell the patients to drink a lot of water with the cough syrup. Sometimes it may cause nausea and vomiting, and this can be reduced by taking it after meals. Now the dosage in children 12 years and above is 200 to 400 milligram every 4 hours. You don't have to exceed more than 2400 milligram in 24 hours. Whereas children 6 to 12 years, again there is no dosage given for children less than 6 years. It's 100 to 200 milligram every 4 hours, and you don't exceed more than 1200 milligram in 24 hours. Most of your cough syrups in a 5 ml contain quantity enough that is not going to cause you toxicity. So you really don't need to check on a cough syrup whether the guaifenesin dose is correct or not. Okay, most of the cough syrups are pretty okay. That 5 ml or 10 ml is not going to give you a lot of problems, and you're not going to prescribe every 4 hourly. Nobody's going to take it. At the most, you'll be giving 6 hourly or 8 hourly. Cough suppressants, basically, whenever you have a very irritating dry cough and you need to control that because you're not sleeping, that's the time you give a cough suppressant, but you have to make sure there's no mucus production. It only helps you in proper sleeping, irritability, and let the child feel better. Now, there are 2 types. One is dextromethorphan and the other is codeine. The difference between the two is dextromethorphan, it's an opioid derivative, whereas codeine is an opioid itself. So this is a derivative, it has no analgesic or additive effects, it does not cause addiction. Both act centrally by elevating threshold for coughing without inhibiting the ciliary activity. Duration of action is 8 hours, so you can get away with giving 8 hourly or 12 hourly dextromethorphan. Don't use it in children with allergic tendency because it can cause allergic reaction. Lot of times for pertussis, lot of patients are prescribed dextromethorphan, whooping cough. They feel that if we control the whoop by giving dextromethorphan, it's better. But be careful in younger children when you're using for pertussis. They may suddenly go into cyanosis and all that. Don't use it. Just leave the patient alone. Probably a macrolide is all that you need to give. You don't need to give a cough suppressant there. Sometimes they do have bronchospasm also, whooping cough. And if you give a cough suppressant, that bronchospasm will aggravate. Don't use it with antidepressants, these dextromethorphan, because they have a CNS effect. In fact, we use dextromethorphan for one of the metabolic disorders known as hyperglycemia. Glycemia. So for that, dextromethorphan is used. We hardly use dextromethorphan in children. Very rarely we've used it in older children. So usually you can get away with just counseling the parents and telling them to take salt water gargles. So that's what works, salt water gargles. Dextromethorphan dosage, adult dosage is 20 milligram every 6 to 8 hours. In children you have various weight bands. According to the weight bands, the various dosage are given. Again, you don't need to remember all these dosage, but because most of your cough syrups will have not very high quantity of dextromethorphan in their cough syrups. You'll hardly get 1 or 2 milligram per 5 ml as cough syrup. Overdosage can lead to drowsiness, hallucinations, blurred vision, dilated pupils, urinary retention. Same as codeine, urinary retention, constipation, shallow breathing, hypertension. So same action as codeine that you will get. Codeine is an opioid derivative. So it's got an opioid action, so it's very addictive. It also acts in the CNS to increase the threshold. Most important aspect of codeine is a lot of patients will complain of constipation with codeine. The moment you give them codeine, the next problem that comes up is constipation. Urinary retention is not that much of a problem, but constipation is definitely there. Their pupillary dilatation and respiratory depression can occur with overdosage. In fact, I was searching for codeine syrup recently for one of my patients who was not getting control with dextromethorphan. And when I prescribed, the next moment I get a call after a few hours saying that codeine syrup is completely out of market. So it has been banned and it's not available currently in India, codeine. Dosage is 1 milligram per kg per day in 4 divided doses. And adults is 10 to 20 milligram every 4 to 6 hours. Then you have decongestants. Now decongestants are basically for the nose. So whenever you want to control the rhinitis, that's the time you control. Give a decongestant. They act by causing vasoconstriction. So there's always going to be a rebound phenomenon. If you use too much of it, there'll be a rebound and they will tend to have more rhinorrhea afterwards. So you have xylometazoline, you have phenylephrine, pseudoephrine and oxymetazoline. Xylometazoline and oxymetazoline are available as nasal drops. Pseudoephrine is available as oral syrup. Earlier we used to get phenylpropylamine, which is not now recommended because of the risk of hypertension. So most of your cough syrups now don't contain phenylpropylamine. They give you nasal congestion, good relief, very good relief, especially at night if the nose is blocked, then it really helps you. But again, side effects of tachycardia, palpitations, arrhythmias. In fact, whenever we get a child with palpitations, the first thing that we ask is, have you taken any nasal drops? Have you been drinking too much of tea coffee? Okay, because all these aggravate the palpitations. So tachycardia, palpitations, arrhythmias are the major problem, and prolonged use obviously is going to cause that rebound phenomenon. Now, xylometazoline, you have two things. You have 0.1%, which is used for adults. So when you prescribe xylometazoline, you have to write pediatric nasal drops. Because if you write just the brand name, it will come to you as they will buy the adult drop and then use that. Though they say that you use 6 to 8 hours in each nostril, what I tell the patients is nighttime is the major problem for a nasal block, only use it at night. In the daytime, use saline drops.
Are they now come in spray form?
Yeah, you just use saline.
Become drops.
Only saline you use, so that during the daytime it gets the secretions out. And saline is not dangerous. Whereas this, if they use too much, because parents, what you write and what they do is sometimes very different. Okay, so you need to be very careful of what you're prescribing, and if they feel that this medicine really works, they'll keep on using it. So I tell them use this only at night and don't use it for more than 3 days, because then it's going to cause more problems. So this is, so even though you can use it so frequently, you give them a lesser margin. So if they use it more frequently, they are still in the safer range.
But then they call speculative access, madam.
Yes. The rebound phenomenon. Then phenylephrine, 2.5 milligram every 4 to 6 hours, and 2 to 6 years, and more than 6 years, 5 milligram every 4 to 6 hours is what we are supposed to use. Then we got antihistaminics. They are the histamine receptor antagonists. Basically, it's used for rhinorrhea again and sneezing. The most important of every side effect of every antihistaminic that we've come across is sedation. They all go to sleep. So younger children, it's okay. And the other thing is it dries up the secretions actually. So what happens, the nose doesn't feel better. They feel more stuffy after using an antihistaminic. You had the first generation, chlorpheniramine, diphenhydramine, okay? And they cause a lot of sedation. You have the second generation, cetirizine, loratadine, pexofenadine. Less sedation. Pexofenadine, don't use it in children less than 6 years. Less than 6 years, stick to cetirizine. More than 6 years, you could use loratadine, pexofenadine. And remember, these antihistaminics basically should be used for allergies, not for regular viral rhinitis. Okay, they should not be used for that. For regular viral rhinitis, just use saline drops. That's what is required. So chlorpheniramine dose is 2 to 6 years is 1 milligram every 4 to 6 hours. 6 years and 12 years, 2 to 4 milligram every 6 to 8 hours. Diphenhydramine, I don't think I need to go through the doses except for cetirizine. Remember the dose. Cetirizine is from 6 months onwards. And it's 2.5 milligram OD, once a day dose. After 2 years, you could use it at 5 milligram once a day dose. And 2 to 5 years, again 5 milligram once a day. So cetirizine is one antihistaminic you use once a day. Loratadine is also to be used once a day. Pexofenadine can be used twice a day. You have pexofenadine available as syrups and tablets, 30 milligram, 60 milligram, 120 milligram. So 6 to 11 years is 30 milligram twice a day. 12 years and above is 60 milligram twice a day. So remember cetirizine, remember chlorpheniramine, and remember pexofenadine. Okay, these doses you remember. And remember, cetirizine is once a day. Chlorpheniramine can be given 4 to 6 times, whereas pexofenadine is twice a day. Then you have these mucolytics, your ambroxol and bromhexin. What they do is they make the mucus that is secreted, a serous mucus is secreted, so not very thick. So it makes the phlegm thinner and less sticky. They are useful in lower respiratory tract infections with a thick mucus. Guaifenesin was in that respiratory tract, whereas this is for thick mucus. So conditions that produce thick mucus, bronchiectasis, cystic fibrosis. So they are not to be used for acute pneumonias, mucolytics. Mucolytics are for a more chronic lung disease, like tracheobronchitis, bronchiectasis, or cystic fibrosis. They increase the bronchial secretion volume. The expectorant, what it does, it gets water inside, right? So the secretion volume is increased, whereas mucolytics help to loosen the thick secretion. So there's a difference between the two. Bromhexin, ambroxol, acetylcysteine, and you have Dornase alpha. Dornase alpha is only used for cystic fibrosis, nothing else. Acetylcysteine, your mucomixed, is basically used in COPD patients. Bromhexin and ambroxol are basically what is used commonly for most of the patients. And ambroxol is basically a metabolite of bromhexin, so one can be used for the other. Acetylcysteine is also available as for nebulization. So you have mucomist available as a nebulization. So only use it for, we use acetylcysteine in patients with cystic fibrosis. We don't use mucomist otherwise, or patients who've been on ventilator and then they have tracheostomy and very thick secretions, that's the time we've been using mucomix. Otherwise we don't use that. Then we come to bronchodilators. We all know salbutamol, terbutaline, beta-2 agonist. Basically used only for a wheeze. Whenever you hear a wheeze, you use bronchodilators. Again, it can cause tachyphylaxis, so you should not be using it very long duration. Prolonged bronchodilator use could lead to tremors and tachycardia also. If you're using, suppose you're giving nebulization with bronchodilators like beta-2 agonist, sometimes we give in the hospital, sometimes we give 4 hourly. every 4 hours. Then it can cause hypokalemia also. So one of the treatment for high serum potassium is actually to give them bronchodilators. So be careful when you're using bronchodilators as nebulizer also. If you're using, then you could use Duolin, which has a beta receptor agonist sparing effect when you're using Ipraven together. Dose of salbutamol is 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg per day. Per dose, sorry. 0.1 to 0.2 milligram per kg per dose. So if you remember that, you don't need to remember the weight bands. Maximum is 4 milligram, which we use in adults. So try and remember 0.1 milligram per kg per dose and 4 milligram as a stat dose that you could use. Don't use more than that. Tobutalin is half of that. It's 0.05 milligram per kg per dose, 3 times daily. So remember it that way, salbutamol or tobutalin. Now we come to these combination cough syrups. Most of the cough syrups that we are going to have are combination. Probably we'll get salbutamol plain available to us. We'll get cetirizine available to us plain. We'll get fexofenadine available to us plain. We are usually going to, probably dextromethorphan, we may get plain. But rarely we are going to come across CPM or phenylephrine as alone. We may get CPM still available as a tablet, which is plain. Okay. You would get those available. But otherwise, most of your syrups, guaifenesin, is going to come with terbutalin and ambroxol. You're not going to get it as a separate thing. Again, the suppressants are going to have phenylephrine and dextromethorphan. Rarely you'll get dextromethorphan, your last SLA. You'll rarely get it as simple dextromethorphan. And decongestants will be a combination of antihistaminic, decongestant, and an analgesic. So these are the combinations. These are correct combinations. But if you get a combination of guaifenesin and dextromethorphan, that's wrong. If you get ambroxol with dextromethorphan, that's wrong. And there are quite a few cough syrups which come like that. And the top selling medicine in India, cough syrups. This is Times of India news. And it says we've got Fencidil cuffs, Linctus and Corex cough syrup. The top most selling brand in 2006. So it's, and Corex is a combination of 4 things. So it's really, we are using a lot of cough syrup. Wanted to discuss one case. 6-year-old girl came to me with cough and cold for 15 days. She had fever and inability to breathe properly for the first 4 days. She was overweight, she was 40 kilos at 6 years. Her respiratory rate was 36, but she didn't have a lot of distress. Chest examination showed a lot of conducted breath sounds. She tend to keep her mouth open continuously. And when I checked her sinuses, she had tenderness in the right maxillary sinus. Throat was normal. What do you think this child has? So probably she had a maxillary, I found a right maxillary sinus tenderness. So probably she was having a maxillary sinusitis. And that was causing a lot of rhinitis also, and a post-nasal drip. And that was making her keep her mouth open and difficulty in breathing. So this is her X-ray, which shows that there is a right-sided. You can see this right is completely opaque. So there is a right-sided maxillary sinusitis. Now the thing is this acute or chronic? No, but if she has sinusitis for a long time, then she should have had symptoms of cold, right from a very long time.
Headache, cold.
Yeah, her symptoms have been only there for 15 days. So acute sinusitis, sinusitis lasting less than 4 weeks is known as acute. Chronic lasts longer than 8 weeks. Subacute is 4 to 8 weeks. Why is it necessary to know this? Is because the organisms differ. The organisms in acute sinusitis probably would be more viral. Among the bacteria, it would be more of streptococcus, H. influenza. Whereas if you take chronic sinusitis, it would be more of anaerobes. It would be more of Moraxella. It may be more of staphylococcus. So the organism changes. So your antibiotic choice changes actually. Now, you came to that age about sinusitis. What age? So maxillary and ethmoid sinuses are present at birth. The sphenoid sinuses come at 3 years. And the frontal sinuses appear at 7 years. So you could get maxillary and ethmoid sinusitis earlier. Complete pneumatization is reached by 12 years for maxillary and ethmoid sinus. and mid to late adolescence for frontal and sphenoid sinuses. But even if you are partially pneumatized, you could still get sinusitis appearing. Now the question is, what cough cold medication are you going to use in this shell?
Decongestant.
Okay, we'll give her a decongestant. What else? So decongestants is all that you'll give, or you want to give an analgesic? Analgesic in the form of anti-inflammatory. So you want to give an anti-inflammatory. You want to give a decongestant in this shell. Antihistaminic? But what will happen is antihistaminic will also dry out. So probably whatever mucus you want to come, get it out of the maxilla, may not come out. But you can give a trial there. So you will give a decongestant. For chronic sinusitis, you need a very potent anti-inflammatory. You will need steroids. For acute sinusitis, you could get away with just NSAIDs as an anti-inflammatory. So not always paracetamol is meant for fever. Sometimes you give paracetamol, especially in otitis media and sinusitis, for its anti-inflammatory action. Then,
and safer.
Saline nasal drops. Okay, so you would be giving topical decongestants, so probably xylometazoline or oxymetazoline. Topical steroids could be used, antibiotics and saline nasal drops. Antihistaminics, be careful when you use for sinusitis, it may just not work. Same thing for otitis media, antihistaminics may not work.
What is the role of topical steroids in this?
Only for chronic sinusitis. So anyone who has sinusitis more than cold, lasting more than 8 days, you documented a sinusitis, it's only for its anti-inflammatory action. The most potent anti-inflammatory. So that's, steam will aggravate. What will happen is, at that time the mucus will all come out, but then the mucus becomes all thicker and then goes back into the sinuses. So steam inhalation is actually contraindicated in sinusitis. So use of cough syrup should be judicious in children. OTC should not be used in children less than 6 years of age. And combination cough syrups need to be used with caution.